For far too long, I've stayed relatively silent on the matter of the YouTuber Harmful Opinions, who I will refer to as Harmless Exaggerations, and his crusade against the social media app Candid, which I helped to promote. And anyone who's familiar with Harmless Exaggerations' content knows that he's a bit obsessed with Candid. He's made at least 8 videos on the subject and participated in several Google Hangouts discussing it as well. I didn't address it before because there are always folks like Harmless who want to make every molehill into fucking Mount Everest. And I assumed his shelf life would be pretty short, but he's proven himself to have staying power, so I think he should be addressed. The argument Harmless puts forth in regards to shills like me is similar, I think, to the sentiments of Bill Hicks in this clip.
Here's the deal, folks. You do a commercial, you're off the artistic roll call forever. End of story, okay? You're another corporate fucking shill. You're another whore at the capitalist gangbang. And if you do a commercial, there's a price on your head. Everything you say is suspect, and every word that comes out of your mouth is now like a turd falling into my drink.
But personally, I've always been a bigger fan of George Carlin, whose message on advertising is just a little different.
This next thing is about advertising. And by the way, if you should have any cognitive dissonance about the fact that I do commercials for 10, 10, 220 and still attack advertising up here, well, you're just gonna have to figure that shit out on your own, okay?
I'll go one step further than George went. I won't make you figure it out on your own. The answer to why he attacked advertising and understood the inherent deceit of advertising and yet still did commercials is actually very simple. It's so simple that every one of you watching this already knows what it is. He was forced by the reptilians. Or it might have just been, you know, a matter of money. And when money's involved, some people think that all objectivity just, woo, it just flies right out the fucking window. I've heard so many times from people that I was bought and paid for by Candid, that Candid had me on a tight leash. Sorry, but that's not really what Candid bought from me. What they bought was a series of 2-minute advertisements on my channel for which I was fairly compensated. But I want it known here and now that I have written to Bindu Reddy, the CEO of Candid, and I've told her that I will not promote Candid in the future. This is despite the fact that we were in talks to do more ads. The reason I gave her is that while I do like the app, the messaging that was given to me on how to promote it, in retrospect, seems to be, in my opinion, deceptive. It does not, in my eyes, accurately describe the application. You know, I pride myself on this channel on speaking the truth as I see it. And while I was paid to promote the Candid app, I was not agreeing at that time to say things that were deceptive, which I now feel is exactly what happened. Now, my first Candid ad, actually, I think is pretty accurate. I think it highlights anonymous aspects of Candid, like the fact that you have no set screen name, so you don't have to worry about family and friends taking you to task for opinions that you put online. That was an honest sales pitch. But the second ad that they had me do was saying that Candid is a free speech platform that is going to be more friendly towards free expression than Twitter or Google or Facebook and all of those. And that simply, I don't think is true. I don't think Candid is any worse than any of those sites when it comes to free speech issues, and it might even be a little better. But ultimately, it's about the same. But just because I've formally severed my ties with Candid doesn't mean I don't have criticisms of Harmless Exaggerations and his practices. So let's get into those. Who is this floating meat wad impersonator? And what is his grievance with Candid? And what is his grievance with me? We have to answer that before proceeding. So a number of months ago, many YouTubers like myself began to advertise a new social media app called Candid. And for the members of the skeptic community on YouTube, we were given a sales pitch by Candid, wherein we were told to emphasize the free speech and anonymity elements of the app. I don't think I can divulge how much money I made from these spots due to contractual reasons, but suffice to say it was substantive. Now, Candid was far from the first time on my channel that I shilled something on camera. So I completely expected there to be a backlash, because there's always a backlash when you're a YouTuber and you openly shill a product. Mostly due, I think, to the reasons outlined by the great Mr. Hicks. We can play that clip again. It's Bill Hicks. He's funny.
Here's the deal, folks. You do a commercial, you're off the artistic roll call forever. End of story. Okay? You're another corporate fucking shill. You're another whore at the capitalist gangbang. And if you do a commercial, there's a price on your head. Everything you say is suspect, and every word that comes out of your mouth is now like a turd falling into my drink.
But with Candid, at first, there was almost no backlash. Tons of people told me they spent all night on it. They said it was great. They said they loved it. And I thought to myself, wow, people actually really like this product. There's not going to be a backlash this time. And that, at the time, I was relieved. Like, oh, cool. You know, I got to make this money. I got to promote this product. And the people actually like the product. So, wow. But then, Harmless Exaggerations put out his first Candid video. And I say first because ever since then, he's been pretty much on a nonstop crusade against this app and anyone foolish enough to support it, to the point where he actually told me point blank in conversation that anyone who even supports the app on any level, is on his shit list. So, holy shit. What did this fucking app do? Well, Harmless Exaggerations took issue with the fact that while Candid was pushing itself as a free speech app on YouTube, they were actually working on a new AI that could intelligently sort through comments and divide people into categories and create a complex system of filters that basically segregated people of certain personality types, and it kept them from intermingling. So for instance, if you were branded as a hater, you might be shadow banned from large portions of the platform. So what Harmless Exaggerations was basically saying was, this platform claims to be a free speech platform, but it's really not. It's being used as a testing ground for a new censorship AI. Now, I don't know about you, but if I were in a situation where I just downloaded this new app because it's supposed to be a free speech platform, and then it comes to light that it's not really as free speech oriented as the advertising claimed, I would either just delete that app and say, oh well, guess that's not really what I thought it was. Or I'd say, well, it was advertised deceptively, but I still like it, so I'm going to keep using it. And either of those reactions seem totally sane and totally sensible to me. But that wasn't what happened. Instead, Harmless Exaggerations and his followers started portraying Candid not just as an app that wasn't as free speech oriented as it claimed, and instead started saying that it was an actual threat to freedom of speech. Candid's AI, which was designed to moderate Candid, was suddenly being portrayed as if it were Skynet or HAL.
You see, if you use Candid, you are being used as a guinea pig in a censorship AI experiment. Candid, becandid.com, is one of my greatest sci-fi nightmares come to life. I can't prove this, but I have a feeling a bunch of YouTubers have traded your trust for cash so that you'll become a little rat in a wheel helping their AI get better.
I can't prove this, but I have a feeling.
Now, in a broader sense, are moderation AIs a threat to freedom of speech? I think an argument could certainly be made that they are. But YouTube already uses such AIs, Facebook uses them, Twitter uses them. All of these major social media platforms are constantly developing these technologies. And in fairness to Harmless Exaggerations, he has made videos attacking AIs from these large companies. But compared to his laser focus on Candid, he barely mentions them. Don't even think he's ever mentioned Twitter or Facebook. Maybe he has. Now let me just ask you a simple question. Whose moderation AIs pose a bigger threat to freedom of speech? Facebook's, Google's, Twitter's, or Candid's? I think anyone would have to say that Candid ranks lowest in the order of concern, for the simple reason that they only have a small percentage of the social media market share in comparison to the social media and search engine giants I just listed. So what started off for me as one of my least contentious advertising spots became the most controversial one ever. So controversial that I'm still having to deal with the fallout months and months later. Put yourself in my shoes for a minute. I know a lot of you aren't too big on empathy, but just give it a shot. You're me. I know it's scary. You own a big YouTube channel and you're kind of controversial. So you don't get much in the way of advertisers. But one day, someone comes to you and says, here's a huge amount of money. Advertise my social media app. It's a big free speech app. All your fans will love it. And you take the deal because the money's good and you looked at the app and it looks good. And you've worked with this company before and they've always treated you well. You think you've got a new successful partnership that's actually willing to invest in you and your content and the content of your usually neglected contemporaries. You're going to be making a lot of new income from this partnership. And then out of nowhere, there's this angry mob who thinks that the company you advertised for is pure evil. It's not an exaggeration, by the way. In Harmful Opinions videos, he describes Candid as evil. They're evil and you're just their whore. That's what you are. And I thought to myself about Harmless, I'm like, who is this guy turning the internal moderation features of this app into this widespread bane on free speech? Why is he acting like this relatively obscure social media platform is basically the devil of the internet? Why has he made so many videos on this issue? Well, maybe he saw a bunch of skeptic YouTube channels pushing Candid, and he thought, I can cast Candid as the worst villain ever to exist, and cast all the people who advertised for them as whores at the capitalist gangbang a la Bill Hicks, all while simultaneously casting myself as a noble truth seeker who out-skeptic'd the skeptic community. And if any of the people I attack come after me, there's a tailor-made response. Who are you gonna believe? Me, Harmless Opinions, who's just concerned with the truth, or the amazing atheist, who's just a whore on Candid's fucking payroll? And that's exactly how he's dealt with any pushback on his agenda. He calls people whores, or he calls them the sycophants of whores. Meanwhile, his own sycophants browbeat those around them into conformity. 3 times now, fans of his have told me to back down from him and stated that he is God. God. Well, I don't believe in God. I've also heard numerous people claim that he's the greatest YouTuber of all time, when clearly I am. Now, if those aren't sycophants, I don't know who is. Harmless even told me, in a direct conversation, and I quote, if I have the opportunity to fuck with anyone supporting this company in any way, I will. That's the mentality, folks, of someone who is, how do I say this, completely batshit fucking insane. For his arguments about Candid to work, you have to buy into the idea that Candid is not just an obscure social media app that engaged in a dishonest marketing campaign. You have to buy into the narrative that Candid is an active enemy to the very principle of freedom of speech and is working diligently to undermine it at every turn. You have to believe that the AI Candid is developing is going to put an end to internet freedom as we know it, and that the implications of what Candid does are super far-reaching in scope. And if any of that If any of that is even remotely true, I'd just like to ask, where's the evidence? Where is it? Harmless has made tons of videos about Candid, and I've watched most of them at this point. And as far as I can see, he's yet to provide a single solitary shred of evidence that his narrative is true. His entire argument against Candid is based on a premise that he can't even prove.
I can't prove this, but I have a feeling.
But what he lacks in a premise, he makes up for in sheer conjecture. Most of the arguments that Harmless fucking makes fall under a relatively obscure logical fallacy known as argumentum ad baculum. My Latin might not be great there. This is where you shift focus away from the faulty premise by emphasizing instead the negative consequences that would happen if the premise were true. For instance, I could say, my house is haunted. And someone else could say, I don't believe in ghosts, so I don't think your house is haunted. And then I say, well, the ghosts will attack and kill those who don't believe in them, so you'd better accept their existence or risk death. Now, probably the greatest example of an argumentum ad baculum is the concept of hell. If you don't obey God, you don't believe in God, you'll burn in hell. This is also a form of emotional appeal. It's basically, if you don't believe my premise, bad things will happen to you. It's sort of a threat. In fact, the Latin translates roughly to appeal to the stick. As in, if you don't believe this line of bullshit, you get the stick. Watch Harmless Opinions videos. Watch them. Watch them. Go watch them. Go type harmful opinions candid and go watch his fucking candid videos. And you will see that Harmless is basically saying that if you don't believe in his dystopian conspiracy where Candid is just the tip of the spear that is used to murder freedom of speech, then you will be subject to said dystopian future and you will find your rights trampled on and taken away. And he has to rely on that tactic. Because if you just view Candid as a shitty app that dubiously claimed to be a free speech platform, then the problem is solved. The moment that you delete the app or decide that you just don't give a shit. But if that's all Candid is, then you can't have a big moral crusade, can you? And if there's no moral crusade, then Harmless Exaggerations doesn't get to make video after video after video about the Candid boogeyman that's hiding behind every bush and under every rock, just waiting until your guard is down so it can steal your freedom of speech away. Gonna change gears here for a moment. Gonna change focus. If you do YouTube as your career, the way you make money is simple. Advertising. People write me all the time to tell me things like, TJ, there's a Mormon ad on your latest video, or something like that. And there's this expectation from them that I should somehow refuse the ad or do something about it. Well, when I enable ads on a video, I have no ability whatsoever to control what comes up. I have no ability whatsoever to decide who can and can't advertise on my channel. And if the Church of the Latter-day Saints wants to waste their money on an ad before my fucking video, I'm honestly totally okay with that. But even if I weren't, I have no control. The second that you as a YouTuber click that monetization button, you've essentially just put a big billboard out in front of your yard that anyone can advertise on regardless of how you perceive them. So you might be a liberal, but you'd have to accept that if you want that billboard money, you might have a big Trump ad in front of your house. You might not like it, you might not agree with it, but it's paying for your mortgage, so you learn to separate it from yourself. Any YouTube channel you watch that has ads on their content has made that deal. But that's not the only sort of advertising that exists on YouTube. There's a much more contentious form of advertising wherein the on-screen personality directly shills, sanctions, and endorses a product, like I did with Candid. And these are always more controversial because it's easy to look at the big billboard in your front yard and say, well, that's separate from me. But when someone pays you to go out into your front yard with a bullhorn and yell out a script that they've given you, it's harder to look at that and say, that's separate from me. So there's a greater impetus there to be careful about who you sell your bullhorn rights to, or if you should even do that at all. Because if you endorse a product that sucks, that can undermine your credibility. And that's what happened with Candid. The things they had me say about their platform weren't true. It's not a free speech platform. And why they ever chose to market it that way, I don't know. And the onus probably was on me to check into them more deeply before I agreed to do the spots. But my belief was, and honestly still is, that people are smart enough to separate advertising from reality. I didn't think it really mattered whether or not I shilled the product because people would decide for themselves anyway. I mean, let's be real here, guys. When I pop on camera for 2 minutes just to say, hey guys, Amazing Atheist here, want to tell you about this great new product, no one's the least bit confused about what's going on. No one thinks for a second that I just was so overwhelmed with love for a product or service to the point where I just had to make a video about how great it is. You know damn well I was paid. You know damn well that I'm shilling a product because I was financially compensated to do so. So you have all of the context that you need to understand what's going on. Nonetheless, if I do these videos in the future, a stipulation will have to be that a disclaimer will appear at the beginning of the video saying that it's a paid advertisement so that no one can possibly have any doubt. Now, since all of this happened a really long time ago, some of you are probably wondering why this issue is being suddenly brought up now. Well, I ended up inadvertently reopening this can of worms when I was talking about my Patreon pledges on a live stream a few days ago. And I mentioned very briefly in that live stream that I pulled my patronage from Teal Deer because I saw he had Harmless on his show to talk about Candid. A lot of people were upset that I revoked my patronage for this reason. Look, I can do with my money whatever I please. I'm in no way obligated to give Teal Deer my money. The reality is that I was a patron of his for many months and he got plenty of money out of me. But when I saw he was giving a platform to someone who I view as a paranoid lunatic who has personally attacked me several times, I withdrew my support. That's 100% my right to do that. Now, I probably shouldn't have mentioned publicly that I did so because that sends the message like I'm condemning Teal Deer or something. I have no condemnation towards him whatsoever. I just didn't want to be a patron any longer. Personal choice. The fact of the matter is that I give generously every month to Sargon of Akkad, The Rubin Report, Thunderfoot, Armored Skeptic, The Bible Reloaded, Dark Matter 2525, Logicked, Creationist Cat, Jacqueline Glenn, Shoe on Head, Chris Raygun, and many more. And I do it because I like what those people are doing, and while I don't always agree with them, and they don't always even agree with each other, they do put forth ideas and opinions that I think are worthy of thought and discussion. And I do it because I believe in a concept that Harmless has recently attacked me for. Solidarity. The concept of solidarity. And at this point in the video, I think it's appropriate to take a brief look at some sections of the exchange that I had with Harmless on Twitter the other day, so I can give you a better idea of the exact nature of our interactions, and you can take a closer look into his mindset, and I guess mine too. And I want you to see particularly how he twists words and tries to force a narrative that simply isn't happening, which is a definite pattern of behavior with him.
Because those people don't understand the solidarity that we share as creators. What you did was reprehensible, and I don't care if others perceive it differently. To which he says, what? And this really was what got under his skin. The solidarity thing. When he made his video about this conversation, he called it skeptic solidarity, which in his opinion is a bad thing. Not a good thing. It's groupthink. We're all part of a fucking cabal of crazy, we must all live by this code. I said, what in the bot? He said, are you trolling me with that shit? I said, not at all. said intersexual YouTube, intersectional YouTubism. I said, not at all. He says, is it something other people agree with or is it just your thing? Because you've gone off on YouTubers before, right? What do you mean by creators? And I said, oh, you don't even get what I'm saying. It's sort of a long explanation. And he asked if it was written anywhere or if I could just give him the gist of it because he said it sounds cultish. Cultish. Solidarity between a bunch of people who do the same job is cultish. Well, I guess every fucking labor union in America or abroad is a cult. I guess when a bunch of people get together and say, hey, I think we share a lot of interests in common. I think that what's good for me is ultimately good for you because what we do is very similar. That is cultish! Are you fucking kidding me? I should be the one asking you if I'm being trolled, bitch. Are you insane? That's a rhetorical question. Yes, you are. The most succinct way I can say it is that I felt you sabotaged the business opportunities of creators. We don't attract a lot of advertisers in the anti-SJW/skeptic communities. So to me, as someone who makes my living doing this, you're attacking an advertiser willing to sponsor us and basically confirming all the fears that potential sponsors have. I should have phrased that better. Because I really didn't, and I kind of clarify this later, but not to the extent I should have. I don't really object him attacking the advertiser. But I did object to the running narrative throughout all of his videos on this subject that everyone who did promotions for Candid are just pieces of shit, total whores, total sellouts, not a word from their mouth can be trusted. Who are you going to believe? Me, the great truth seeker, harmful opinions, or these paid corporate shills? That narrative ran throughout those videos, and that's what I objected to. That's what I continue to object to. So he said, so I should have kept quiet in what I wanted to say to protect potential sponsor slash creators who would be sponsored. Is your viewpoint the norm in your communities? Notice that this is the second time that he's asking me about how widespread this perspective is. Why does he automatically assume that because I have this perspective, that it must be something that's shared among this large group of people? Why does he assume that just because I feel this way and I'm presenting this argument, which, look, if you don't agree with me on this, that's fine. But this is my opinion and my opinion alone. Why is he continuously trying to force the narrative to be that it's not just me who thinks this, it's this cult of people. There's a cult that thinks this way. I said, the reason I hate you is because you point blank cost me mountains of money because you had to attack some fucking obscure social network. If you just attacked them, I would have no grievance, but you attack their advertising campaign directly. I speak for myself, I can't speak for others, in reference to his previous inquiry. I have encountered agreements with my position, but I've taken no polls. Yeah, I mean, I've discussed this with a few people here and there. And you know what? Some people agree with me. They do. There are people out there, many of whom you would recognize their names, who agree with what I say. There are others, many of whom you would recognize their names as well, who do not agree with me. And then there are people who kind of see my perspective and kind of see harmful opinions' perspective. And that's fine. Everyone's thinking, that just shows everyone's thinking for themselves. Everyone has their own ideas. If everyone was just in cliquish agreement about this and every time this was brought up, this is just the reaction, then I would understand his line of inquiry. But as it stands, I don't. I tell him a personal opinion of mine, and he instantly tries to extrapolate it to, oh, well, how many others believe this? How big is this? He says, but like you've discussed this with other creators. I say yes. And they, yeah, I just covered this, so we don't need to go over that. I basically told him what I just told you guys, that some have agreed with me, some haven't, and his summation of that is, so basically, overall, y'all are crooked as fuck. Well, if you think that it's crooked to want to make money doing what you do for a living, then, yeah, I guess it's crooked. If you think that just advertising at its essence is just fundamentally wrong, and you just object to it in all its forms, then yeah, it's a crooked way of looking at the world. But if you're a sane, reasonable person who understands that most of these platforms that we all enjoy, like YouTube, are supported by ad dollars and ad revenue, and most of the content creators that are diligently producing new content for the audience all the time, that if you understand that most of them are subsidized by ad revenue, then no, it's not crooked as fuck. It's just acknowledging the simple pragmatic reality that advertisement is how we make our money. That's how we make our living. And I said basically that. I said, we're crooked because we want sponsorships and financial success. That's a major way how money is made on YouTube. Hell, there have been pro-Islam ads on my videos. There have been PragerU ads and Clinton ads. He asked me, do I know what editorial integrity is? I don't think that me taking ads compromises editorial integrity. Because I'm not changing what I say to fit the mold of what advertisers want. Lots of YouTubers do that. So attack them for it. If you want to. But I've kept my content pretty much 100% the way I want it to be. The only things I don't say are the things that would get me kicked off of YouTube. Like, I would never make a video where I'm wearing blackface or something, because I'd get banned. So I have those lines that I won't cross, but I've never been like, shit, I can't make this video because then I won't attract as many advertisers. Never had that thought cross my mind, and I think anyone who watches my content can realize that in fairly short order. But apparently not harmful opinions. I ask him, do you know what ridiculously hyperbolic statements from a histrionic drama whore is? Because I'm, of course, accusing him of being just that. And I think it's a fair accusation. If you compromise what you say to ensure sponsorships for you or others, you don't have it, basically. And everything you say is dirt. Well, that's fine then, because I haven't done that. Never have done that. Never will do that. So suck a dick. I said, I don't censor content to make it advertiser friendly. That's why I don't have many sponsors. But Candid was willing to put ads on my channel as it was. And he says, you complaining about hyperbole, though? Come on. I said, you outdo me, sir, in the hyperbole department. He asked for an example. I told him that him saying that Candid sponsorship is indicative of a loss of editorial integrity strikes me as ludicrous hyperbole. And he says he didn't say that. Well, yeah, I mean, he did say that. I told him, I made a fucking case for why YouTubers take ads and how the ads don't always necessarily reflect what you believe or what you think. And he immediately says, do I know what editorial integrity is? Well, from that, I read that that he thinks I've lost my editorial integrity because I did spots for Candid. So that's exactly what he's saying. Now, the conversation continues on and on like that for quite some time. And he keeps asking how widespread it is. And you see that here. He's trying to gauge how widespread it is. said, you don't need to enforce it if it's the norm. I said, I don't know what the norm is. He says, seeing as you're sort of a figurehead of your community or movement or whatever, I figured you'd have a feel. I told him I can only speak for myself. I don't have a fucking community, really. I don't have a movement. What I have is there's a group of YouTubers who do similar content to what I do. And a lot of them are in that list of patrons that I outlined earlier in this video, who I feel a certain sense of solidarity with. And the reasons for this solidarity are not hard to fucking understand. Especially, they really should not be hard to understand for someone like Harmful Opinions, who's been banned from YouTube. That's the kind of shit that us YouTube content creators deal with. People trying to ban us. People trying to fucking malign us. People writing fucking deceptive articles about us. I've had articles written about me where I'm described as a right-wing, alt-right YouTuber. I'm left-wing as fuck, dude. But because I have the wrong stance on a few issues like Islam, I'm labeled as a far-right YouTuber in some publications. And that's the kind of shit Sargon deals with. A lot of us deal with this kind of shit. And on top of that, we're the only ones who really know just how much of a time drain this YouTube shit really is. Because for a lot of people, a YouTube video in their mind takes as long to make as it does to watch. And that's not fucking true. Simply not true. Takes a lot of time to write. Takes a lot of time to research, takes a lot of time to figure out just how you want to say things, just what you want to convey, refining the words, refining the process. Only a few other people really understand that shit. And only the people in this little anti-SJW skeptic community really understand the exact pressures that come along with it. So of course, you want there to be some sense of solidarity. And when a new sponsor comes along who's willing to actually invest in the skeptic community, then that's great. We all want that. Now, did it turn out that some of the advertising was deceptive? Yeah, it did. And, you know, I won't give you props for much Harmful Opinions, but I do have to give you props for figuring that out. I do have to give you props for being the one who pointed out that the Emperor had no clothes and seeing that fault. But you didn't have to lambast everyone who was simply just fucking doing a job. You know, someone comes to us and says, here's a bunch of money, we're doing this free speech app. And here's what you say about it. Here's a fucking sample of it. Check it out. See what you think. Get a feel for it. We do that. And we put out the videos. And, you know, maybe we should have done more research into it. Maybe we should have all looked into what it was and made sure that what we were being told about it was true. And as for why we didn't, I think it's probably because usually when you do a sponsorship, this never happens, you know? And I feel like if not for your hyperbole regarding Candid, this wouldn't have been that big of a deal. If you would have just made a video saying Candid's advertising was deceptive, look at this, look at this, look at this, you know, so be aware of what this fucking application really is. If you'd have made that video and left it alone at that and not gone into histrionics and hyperbole, then I don't think that, I don't think anything would have happened. I think a few people would have, you know, deleted the app and said, oh, well, fuck this then. And I think some other people would have said, ah, really, I don't care, so whatever. I still like it. People, you did your job. You informed people, you gave them the tools they needed to make an informed decision, but then you continued to pump shit out that wasn't true, you continued to cast aspersions at people just because They didn't do the research that you did. You decided you were going to look into Candid. Great. You know, we all should have done that. You're the one who did do that. So props to you on that one. But it doesn't change the fact that so much else of what you've said was deceptive. And that's actually what we're about to get into now, because I'm about to take a look at your first Candid video.
Whew! This video is already criminally long, but I think it's time we delve deeper into the abyss of madness. We're going to close this out by watching harmless opinions, or harmless exaggerations, or harmful exaggerations, or whatever the fuck you want to call them. We're going to watch his first ever Candid video and really examine its points.
Hey guys, how's it going? Have you heard about the hot new chat app, Candid? Whoa! Isn't it cool? Well, no, it isn't actually. And this isn't a sponsored video. In fact, the way things are now, I wouldn't touch Candid with a 10-foot pole.
But you'll still maintain a Twitter and a Facebook and a YouTube channel, so I guess your outrage is selective, right? Is that the word? That'd be the word, right?
Recently, I've seen a ton of people here on YouTube promoting Candid, a kind of anonymous chat service. And I thought, with all these guys, people like Shoe on Head, Mundane Matt, Bearing, The Amazing Atheist, and so many others on Candid's payroll, who's going to take a critical look at this? Guess that task falls to me.
So here we see him saying, in essence, these guys are all on Candid's payroll, so I must be the lone voice of truth. I must rise above the fray of shills and ascend to the throne of goodness upon a rainbow of virtue. And it's also highly deceptive, by the way, to describe us as being on Candid's payroll, since exactly zero of us are employees of Candid. We were independently contracted to do advertising spots for Candid. And maybe some of you will say that this is a nitpick, but remember, this guy also describes me as endorsing Bindu Reddy. Endorsing her, as if she's my master. Now, his first point, and really his only valid point, is that Candid's marketing was deceptive. Now, since I've already ceded that point, I'll skip that bit and move ahead a tick.
Candid, becandid.com, is one of my greatest sci-fi nightmares come to life. Brilliant. This sounds like Twitter's horrific shadow banning system times 10.
No, it's actually pretty much just Twitter's horrific shadow banning system times 1. What I'm saying is it's essentially the same as what tons of other sites are doing. Huge sites like YouTube and Twitter and Facebook are not moderated exclusively by human beings, because that would just be too immense of an undertaking. And even if there were human moderators, they would be just as prone to bias as an AI, perhaps even more so. But Harmless has some questions about the AI, and I think I can help him answer them.
How exactly does this work?
Well, are you a programmer with an expertise in AI? Because if not, I don't think you'd understand the explanation, even if it were given to you.
How effective is it? How accurate is it?
Oh, it is 72.6% effective. Actually, I have no idea. I mean, Candid is a functional app that plenty of people use, so I guess it's effective enough that it doesn't prevent the app from being usable.
How could this be changed to clamp down later? Where else could this be applied?
The potential for abuse of such a system does exist, but it's already been developed independently in several places. This is just the forward progress of technology, and most technology can be used for good or bad. This is no different.
How are they making money on this? How can they afford all these sponsorship deals for a free service where, when I looked at it, there were no ads? Could be wrong there, though.
It's called venture capital. Plenty of tech companies have started ad-free services, then waited for their market share to be immense. And only then did they drop the ad bombs on us. Facebook and YouTube didn't have ads at first either, so that's not really very strange.
Is the product actually the AI they're working on?
No, the product is a social network. The AI they're working on is designed to moderate that social network and hopefully give it an edge that it needs to succeed.
Well, while the app is supposed to keep you anonymous and not give you a persistent identity, their FAQ claims that the AI will give you a persistent personality indicator. It says,
Candid uses advanced artificial intelligence in order to perform complex analysis of posts to give you a special badge that represents your social personality. Why would you want this? Part of the beauty of anonymity is that you go in without preconceptions about who said whatever it is they're saying.
Well, on Candid, at least last time I was there, those badges were viewable only by the person who had them. It doesn't display the personality type that you've been designated with to everyone. That's just for your viewing.
And do you really trust this system to label people like that?
If you don't, then don't download the app. Just don't use it. You act like this label is going to be tattooed to people's heads and will affect the course of their entire lives moving forward. We're talking about a fucking feature on a social media app. You can avoid the label and its possible injustice to you by simply deciding not to use the app. This is not like Twitter or Facebook or something that's super pervasive. This is Candid. A little niche app. Why are you freaking out about the features of some niche app?
Do you trust this company? If you use Candid, you'd better, because there's something else that AI is going to be labeling as well. According to a Washington Post article that was published earlier this month entitled Candid Offers an Opportunity to Speak Freely, but Politely, Online, Candid's secret sauce is in its artificial intelligence moderation, which aims to weed out bad actors by analyzing the content of posts and keeping hate speech and threats off the network. But it also has other interesting features. For example, its algorithm tries to weed out false information by marking certain items as rumor or true. That's right, Candid's AI will be deciding and helping you and the masses decide what is true. With handy-dandy labels. Again, what could go wrong?
Any potential for abuse only exists within Candid itself, which once again is totally optional to use. There's absolutely nothing that compels one to use Candid. And with all the talk about fake news lately, Facebook has now adopted this very same feature. So I guess Harmless has probably vacated his Facebook in protest, right? Nope, he's still there! On November 3rd, YouTube adopted an AI comment moderation feature very similar to Candid's. So has Harmless vacated YouTube? Nope, still there too. Now, in fairness, he is critical of these systems, but when Candid did it, he was telling everyone and their brother not to ever use Candid.
This screams stay away to me.
Now that much bigger and more influential platforms are using it, he supports them. And don't get me wrong, he may not support them with his rhetoric, but when he makes videos that draw eyeballs to YouTube, he's tacitly supporting them. When he maintains his Twitter presence and his Facebook presence, he's drawing people to those sites. So he's definitely supporting them. Where's his moral outrage at himself for daring to associate with these companies that are embracing such a sci-fi nightmare?
Candid has a page on a website called Product Hunt that seems quite legit. And underneath their information in the comment section, someone claiming to be a representative of the company has answered some people's questions. And here he is. Hi Product Hunt, I'm Spencer from Candid, and I'm thrilled to share what we've been working on. Can't wait to see what you all have to say, and I'm happy to answer any questions. You'll notice it says he works for MyLikes, but that's because Candid is spun out of MyLikes, and they have the same owners. Anyway, someone asked, isn't this just like Secret? How do you deal with abuse? To which Spencer replied, hey, we use a powerful AI to automatically detect and remove abuse. It's our largest team. All this really means is that loads of non-abusive posts are going to get removed and real abuse is going to stay up for days or weeks. Unless, hopefully, by AI you mean a team of attentive humans. To which Spencer replied, hey Ashley, we don't believe in harassers, meninists, abusive bullshit, etc. They can expect to get kicked out of Candid and will get their comeuppance during the revolution. We have human moderation as well, smiley face. Dunno about you guys, but I find this a little bit concerning.
Yeah, but you have to take that with a grain of salt, don't you? As you point out in this video and many others, this was a company talking out of both sides of its mouth. It went to all the anti-SJW and skeptic channels and said, free speech, free speech. And it went to all the special snowflakes and said, safe space, safe space. Isn't it very possible that this is just an example of a company lying to try to get as many people to join their app as possible just by, you know, telling everyone what they wanted to hear? Because if this company was really so SJW, would they really be giving money to people like me and Shoe on Head and Baring and whoever else was shilling for them?
While I think everything I've shown you so far should be enough to cause concern, there is one more thing I want to point out. I found another clip of Bindu Reddy, the co-founder and CEO of Candid, this time on NPR.com. Turns out this AI isn't just something they've developed and are going to use, it's learning. I'll let her explain.
So the way the artificial intelligence works is it basically, it parses your sentence. We use a deep learning NLP algorithm, which basically looks at what you're saying and decides, A, whether it's positive or negative. So it kind of like, you know, kind of classifies things as having a negative sentiment or a positive sentiment. It then gives it a score of how kind of strong your statement is. Let's say you said something about someone or you threatened someone. Whether it's self-harm or like bullying or harassment, we look for certain phrases and the context of those phrases. And as we like get more data, the algorithm feeds upon itself. So it trains based on more and more data, which we feed to it. And over time, it gets better and better at recognizing some of these posts.
As they feed it data, it gets better and better. Where do you think that data is coming from? Do you think it has anything to do with the people using Candid?
Yeah, it probably does. So what? Where's the smoking gun there? An AI moderator is pretty useless if it can't learn from experience. I mean, they decided to use an AI moderator, so should the moderator just be a piece of shit that never improves? I mean, if you have an objection to AI moderators in general, then I can understand that, even though I don't necessarily agree with it. But if you've accepted that there is an AI moderator, why would you care about it learning and refining its process? What's the concern there exactly? Do you think it's going to achieve sentience and enslave humanity or something?
You know, I can't prove this, but I have a feeling a bunch of YouTubers have traded your trust for cash so that you'll become a little rat in a wheel helping their AI get better.
I can't prove this, but I have a feeling. There's your fucking tagline for your channel, buddy. I can't prove this, but I have a feeling. Well, at least you had the decency to say that. I mean, most of the time when you toss these feelings out there, you just present them as if they're indisputable facts. But thank you for this one time admitting that you're just making shit up based on your feelings. I do appreciate the candidness. I guess it would be candor, but then it doesn't work as a play on words. You see my problem?
Unless this company quickly becomes a lot more transparent, this looks evil as fuck.
Evil! 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 Dude, when you think AI moderation of a social media network qualifies as evil, you gotta screw loose, buddy. Sorry, you gotta screw loose. Where is the inherent nefariousness in that? Candid is totally guilty of deceptively presenting themselves as a free speech zone. I admit that. But to say that their use and refinement of an AI system for comment moderation is tantamount to evil is just more reckless hyperbole. In fact, maybe that should be your fucking name. Not harmful opinions, reckless hyperbole. Or maybe utter paranoia. That'd be a good one too.
To me. Here's a little idea to contemplate for all you tinfoilers out there. What if they're promoting this so heavily amongst anti-SJW or whatever you want to call it, YouTubers, because they want you on it to learn what you're like, to train their AI how to get rid of you, and then sell that AI. Just a thought. I'm pretty sure that's not what's happening, but, you know, just want to encourage a critical eye.
So, you present a theory that you pretty much admit with your tinfoil hat joke is just a conspiracy, and then you say that you yourself don't even believe it. Well, you not believing it sure didn't stop you from trying hard to make others believe it, did it? You spent the last few minutes of this video trying to lead people to believe just that. Did you ever think about the irony of trying to make people afraid of getting kicked off of a social media app that you tell them not to use in the first place? And Candid doesn't need to sell their AI. All the bigger social networks already have them. Candid wasn't the only one developing this technology, and whether you like it or not, it's already here. And it's only going to get more pervasive. Candid is a tiny little blip on the radar compared to the giant companies that have embraced similar technology. You single them out for one reason and one reason only. And I shouldn't even have to tell people by now what that reason is. Hopefully, they've figured it out.
Whatever they're going to do with this tool, though, maybe you don't want to be feeding it. Because, like I said, even if the way these guys are using it is relatively harmless right now, where could this technology go? Why would you trust these people, especially considering this AI, which is obviously so key to their operation, isn't fully explained or shown off on the front page of their website? All they tell you about the AI on one of the tabs of the front page is that it will figure out your personality. There is nothing about its most impressive feature there. You'd think they'd take any opportunity to say, hey, look at this amazing learning AI we've got that will keep conversation clean. They're putting so much effort into it, you'd think they'd advertise it.
They did. You just showed interviews and internet comments and news articles all about Candid's AI. You even showed a part of Candid's FAQ as a reference earlier in this video. So how exactly were they keeping it a secret? You know that if they wanted to keep it a secret, they never would have had to tell anyone about it. There would be no articles about it. There would be no interviews with Bindu Reddy on NPR about it. There's no law that forces them to disclose if they use AI content moderation or not. It's none of anyone's business but theirs. That could be considered a trade secret. They chose to disseminate that information. But you're upset because they didn't blast it out on the front page of Candid? I mean, what kind of weird arbitrary standard is that? So I would like to close this monstrously long video by saying that Harmless does deserve credit. In fact, I should call him by his proper name. Harmful Opinions does deserve credit and props for spotlighting Candid's deceptive ad campaign. But 90% of his videos on the subject are devoted almost entirely to rampant conjecture, hyperbolic declarations of evil, and attacking Candid more for what they could potentially do far more than what they've actually, in fact, done. All of the while, tooting his own horn and labeling all those who disagree with him as whores or the sycophants of whores. He makes far too many assumptions that he can't prove, and he engages in a shit ton of hypocrisy by condemning Candid more harshly than he does larger and more powerful social media sites doing exactly the same things as Candid. He states that the AI moderation is reason enough to never use Candid, yet he is on several platforms that do the same things. And I'm sorry, but that's naked hypocrisy, no matter how you slice it. On the issue of who's ultimately correct between Bill Hicks and George Carlin, everyone out there watching this video can make that determination on their own based on their own value system. And no one on either side of that issue should be accused of groupthink just because they took the side you might not like. As for me, I will continue to be amenable to doing sponsored videos in the future. But I certainly will be more careful about whose promotions I accept. And I will always make sure to clearly label them as promotions. And any advertiser who won't do that, I'll turn their money down. Because credibility is more important to me. So, any sales pitch given to me, whatever it is, I'm going to make sure it's accurate. Because the last thing I want is a repeat of this fucking mess. Now, if you actually made it this far into the video, I thank you very much for listening. And I hope you'll share with me your thoughts on this matter in the comments section down below. I also hope that you'll give this video a thumbs up, although I know a lot of you don't agree with me on this, but maybe I changed some minds. Hopefully I did. If not, pff, fuck me, I guess. I'm the Amazing Atheist, also known as TJ Kirk, also known as Peace the Fuck Out.